Good evening, Sarah, and thanks for the introduction, and good evening, everyone, and thanks to Proactive for inviting me along this evening. I'm very pleased to be here, and that was a great introduction from Sarah. I'm not quaking in my boots because I'm not wearing boots this evening, so you're all right in that respect. I do, however, want to give you a good run through what it is that we're doing here at IOG now and why we think 2021 is going to be another breakthrough year for us. So who are we? We are an AIM-listed gas company, UK gas company, with, as Sarah says, a market cap of a shade under £80 million. Current share price is 16.25 pence. And what we want to be, and are now moving very rapidly towards being, is a material gas producer in the UK Southern North Sea gas base. So the slides that I'm going to show you are going to hopefully fill that out for you and give you a good idea of what we're all about. So the first one I'll go to is the key investment highlights slides. I think a number of points I want to make off here. The first thing is that we are actually funded to first gas, and we're planning to deliver first gas from our core project in the third quarter of this year. How are we funded? We're funded through a carried arrangement with our excellent partner, Cal Energy Resources. Cal, you probably know, are part of the Berkshire Hathaway Energy Group, and they are funding us for phase one of our development for £60 million and another £65 million carry for when we get to phase two. And alongside that, a couple of years ago, we put in place a €100 million bond to fund the balance of our costs and capex through the project. We're very clear as a company about how we want to create value. We believe that the core project will deliver really strong returns for investors and will throw off significant cash. We're working in a basin where we can utilize a very efficient hub strategy, which once we get the hubs in place, allows us to take advantage of incremental opportunities. And a point I'd make, just by its very nature, this is a business with a low carbon footprint. And I'll explain a little bit why on the next slide, but it's really very well positioned to move us forward and adhere to the UK's net zero strategy. I think almost uniquely for a company of our size in the gas basin, in the Southern Gas Basin, we own our own infrastructure. So we own the Thames pipeline and the onshore reception facilities into the Bacton terminal on the Norfolk coast. And that's great because that allows us, A, to get our project up and running and ready to go with a strategic platform, and then to add in incremental opportunities afterwards without too many commercial or operational hurdles. So great position to be in, owning the infrastructure. Alongside that, over the last year and a half, I'm very pleased that we've got with the team that we've been able to put in place now. We have a very high quality team here ready to deliver this project and get us to first gas and cash flow later in the year, with a great deal of experience in the basin itself. And we really are therefore focused on creating significant value from our core project and all the returns we can make when we start to add on incremental opportunities later on. We have a substantial reserve and resource base. We're operator of the core project, 50% with Cal Energy as our 50% partner, obviously. And the gross resources in the six fields in the core project total 420 billion cubic feet of gas. And from that, we're targeting an annual average of 140 million cubic feet a day of gas production. So that's a quick overview of why I think we're a really good investment for the future. The little map here just gives you an overview of where we are. That's at the bottom left of the map. You can see the North Norfolk coast of England and the Bacton terminal, which really is the gateway into the UK gas market, and particularly into the southeast of England UK gas market. Our portfolio is shown on here in yellow. I've already mentioned that we have 2P reserves of 156 billion cubic feet of gas, and then 2C contingent resources in the core project of another 55 BCF. So a material portfolio. But what's special, I think, about our portfolio is, as I've said, we actually own our own infrastructure. I don't know if you can see my pointer on here, but the solid black line bottom left in the map is the Thames pipeline, which we're currently refurbishing, ready for our gas to come through and into Bacton. And that's really been the locus for our efforts over the last few years. I'll come on in a moment and just talk a little bit about phase one of the development and how that's actually going to work. Just a couple of points I wanted to make, though, here. Here we are in the UK gas basin. It's a basin that's very well understood. We understand the geology. It's been producing gas since the mid-1960s. So we understand the plays and the infrastructure and the commercial proposition around us very, very well. Because of that, we're able to take advantage of the basics of the basin, relatively shallow water, relatively benign operating environment, an area where we can bring our gas in. Our fields are really only between 30 and 60 kilometers offshore. So we can bring our fields in via simple, unmanned, automated infrastructure into the Bacton terminal and then into the UK gas market via Bacton and particularly the southeast of England. That means that there's a very established operating environment here. We can use world-class contractors in the area who understand the basin very well. And also it means we can keep a real lid on our capital cost and on our operating costs. We're looking at operating costs of around $5 to $10 a BOE over the life of the fields. So that's what the point I wanted to make, first of all. Great operating environment, lots of low carbon opportunities because we're gas, B, we're reusing existing infrastructure, and C, as much as possible, we're automating what we do offshore and putting as few people offshore and as few processes offshore as we possibly can. So a great simple proposition. I'm also pleased to say, looking at this map, actually, I've just spotted that, in fact, a couple of the lines on here that we laid this in the last couple of months can now be turned black, the line from Elgood into Blyth and then Blyth into the Thames pipeline. Those parts of the development were completed just in the last couple of weeks. So we are making good progress, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. So I said it's going to be in our corporate update on Monday. I said this is going to be another breakthrough year for us. And this slide really gives you a feel for why. I think the 2019 was all about us getting funded, growing up as a company, and getting to a point where we brought in Cal Energy, our partner, got our bond done, and that really allowed us to take final investment decision at the end of 19 and then start on the project. And through the course of 2020, we've been able to manage our COVID exposure and keep the project moving along. So we've begun construction early last year on our infrastructure, and I'll show you some pictures in just a moment of what it is we're building and what we're going to put in place. We got our field development plan approval from the UK government back in April last year. We were successful in adding to our portfolio in the 32nd licensing round. And then in the latter part of 2020, we began to lay our pipelines in the southern North Sea to connect up to our main trunk line into Bacton and get that work going offshore as well, and get ready for development drilling, which will be starting soon in the next couple of months. Alongside that, we've been working very hard onshore at the Bacton terminal, where we're refurbishing the Thames reception facility. So everything moving along nicely, and we continue to target first gas for the third quarter of this year, by which time we'll have drilled the initial development wells, and then we'll be carrying on through 21 and into 22 with further development drilling. So really, I'd characterize it as 2019 getting funded, 2020 a great year, even though we faced a lot of headwinds from the pandemic, but a great year. We've held things on track, and we continue to make great progress with the development. And then this year, moving towards first gas. And what does that really mean? Moving towards cash flow and revenue and free cash flow around about the end of the year. So all progressing very well with a great team put in place through the course of 2020. A little bit more overview on that. The diagram on here actually shows what it is we're going to put on the seabed for phase one of our core project. Basically, the intent is to hook up three fields, Southwark, Blyth and Elgood. That will be done. We'll need five wells drilled to do that. And all of our main contracts are now let, and our development drilling's ready to go, as I said, in the next few weeks. And we're moving along. All the key contracts are now in place. And we continue to maintain a very strong focus on our costs and on our schedule. And that's really, really important, because ultimately we're about delivering returns. So we've got to be very conscious of capital cost, operating cost, because that protects our margins in the long run. So moving towards first gas then in the third quarter, as I've said already, we work very hard to mitigate the challenges from COVID-19. We're very aware of those and really on top of them all the time. We're getting ready also to sell our gas, and we've kicked off now a tender process that will complete in the first half of this year so that we can get all of the agreements in place along the gas chain and be ready to go later on in the third quarter. So very pleasing overview in terms of where we've got to with the development so far and what we've managed to achieve with phase one. The bulk then of phase one is now getting ready to be installed through the first quarter of this year and into the second quarter of this year, and drilling, as I say, development drilling to start later on in this quarter of 2021. If we just pop on to the next slide, some nice pictures there. I think we really see the project as four key work streams currently at the moment. And if I go round clockwise, really from the top left, what you can see there is over in Schiedam in Holland, HSM are building our first two platforms that we need to put in to facilitate phase one for the Blythe and Southwark fields. You can see the Southwark jacket there lying on its side, currently being painted yellow. I'm never sure why they're always painted yellow, but they are. And there is the Southwark jacket lying on its side in the yard over in Schiedam, getting ready for installation, which will be early in the second quarter of this year. And of course, Blythe is being built at the same time over there in the same yard. Top right gives you a feel for Subsea 7, our major contractor there, laying our 12 and 6-inch pipelines that they've just put in the last few months that were installed in Q4 of 2020. What you can see there is the 12-inch line being reeled off the back of the pipe lay vessel and being laid on the seabed. And those pipelines are now in place, hooking up Blythe and Elgood to the Thames pipeline. So that piece of work is done. We continue with the detailed work necessary to get ready to drill the development wells that are going to produce our gas getting ready to start drilling towards the end of the quarter here. Again, there's a lot going on in this first quarter. We've contracted the Noble Hans Jewel to do that work. It's a jack-up rig, ideally suited really for operations in the Southern Gas Basin. And we're very excited about that. And bottom left there, you can see our team there, suitably socially distanced in their orange overalls, actually on the rig, doing an audit of the rig itself up in the Moray Firth. Onshore, we continue to progress work at Bacton Terminal. You can see from the photograph bottom right, our pipeline comes in to what's called the Thames reception area there, and then goes on into the Perenco Terminal, and then through into the National Transition System. We're looking from north to south on this picture, so the NTS is over on the west of the plant. We're doing all the work we can now, and we've just been recently able to take advantage of Perenco's regular autumn shutdown to get a lot of our tie-in work completed just back in November, and then getting ready to bring gas in the third quarter again. So the refurbishment work is ongoing there as well. So moving forward really on all fronts for phase one development of the project. Some of you, if you're familiar with us, will have seen this slide before in our corporate presentation. It's basically the way we look at the world in terms of how we can create value going forward for investors. I think the important thing on this slide is really the strap line at the bottom there that says we're fully focused on fully costed risk IRR, not just on NPV, but on returns for shareholders. Returns are very, very important to us. All the management team and board of shareholders, we're very, very focused on delivering for our investors significant returns. And the way we're set up with the core project in place, and then with the ability to add on incremental projects that will deliver returns, that's something that we're very excited about. We see four key areas where we can grow the company. Obviously, we'll be working, bottom left there, you can see we'll be working on our own portfolio over and above the core project. Well, if we went back to the map at the beginning of the presentation, you'd see that we have an extensive portfolio across the UK Southern Gas Basin, and we're working on that all the time to understand what we can bring in to the infrastructure once it's in place and producing later on this year. We're very keen on being able to access additional opportunities through licensing rounds. We're not an exploration company, so what we've tended to be able to access is already discovered gas that needs a home, and we're very good. We have the team in place to understand, deliver, and engineer that and make that happen. And then we also look around us at, there's a lot of gas been shut in around us recently, so we look around us and see what else we can add in from in terms of field redevelopment in the immediate vicinity of our infrastructure. And again, I make that point again, almost uniquely for a company of our size, because we have access to our own infrastructure, we can actually bring in other opportunities relatively easier and get relatively easily and get them to market. And of course, we keep an eye open all the time for acquisitions in the geographic area and hinterland around the pipeline, so that we can also add through that route too, if we like. But for the moment, focus very much the next few months is on getting the phase one development done, getting to first gas and getting to first revenue and free cash toward the end of the year. What I would say is that we are very pleased to be in a position where we will be producing into the UK gas market. The UK gas market has really still has very strong long-term fundamentals. 20 years ago, the UK was fully self-sufficient in its gas needs. We brought in all of our gas from our own indigenous production. Over the last 20 years or so, that's tailed right off. And now we're at a point where most of our gas is actually imported, either by pipeline from Norway or from continental Europe, or indeed via LNG. Gas supply, however, from our own indigenous gas is obviously dropping off, and demand is not dropping as fast as that. So we're going to be needing more and more gas coming in over the next few years. And indigenous gas is very, very important to the mix, because obviously it's actually the lowest carbon form of gas to come in to the system to be used then for domestic heating, for industry, and then very, very importantly, for electricity generation. So what we want to do then is absolutely to capitalize on that, get our indigenous gas up and running. That will be contributing to where there are great margins for us to take advantage of. And I'll come on in a moment and talk just a little bit about the recent gas price history. We've always looked at the forward curve, so we always take a fairly conservative look at what the gas price is going forward. We've had some very volatile months in the gas market, but we're now seeing a strengthening that hopefully will help us very much in the near future to deliver on our promise of return. So I'll come on to that a little bit more in just a moment.
You've got the next slide. 1 minute left.
Okay, thank you, Sarah. And here is indeed a day ahead chart that shows you basically the gas price through the course of last year and then into early this year. And it's shown up the side there as pence per therm, which is the unit that's used to price UK gas coming into the market. And you can see that prices basically went into the doldrums with the onset of the pandemic, a reduction of demand last summer. But then since really around about August last year, they've started to pick up. And then as we've seen the UK being exposed to supply squeezes because of a lot of LNG has gone to Asia over the last few weeks, then the prices have really picked up. And we're now looking at day ahead prices, which increased up to nine times between May last year and January this year. And there's also high demand there because we're having a colder than expected winter. So we're actually pleased to see this in terms of our forward look, because we'll be producing into a much more stable and higher priced gas market than we previously would have been. So this is good for us as a producer, and we're looking forward to getting on stream in Q3 of this year and taking advantage of the improved commodity outlook. Just very quickly, I probably used up my minute, Sarah, but I just will very quickly, my last slide, obviously, well, why invest in us? And I just wanted to make a few points at the end here. We are very, very focused, as I said, on per share valuation metrics and accretion. We, all, as management, we're all shareholders. We really value returns and cash flow over simply producing as much volume as we can. We're disciplined in terms of our approach to capital. We look very closely at all of our incremental opportunities and assess them against fully costed and risked IRR targets, as well as just having a strategic fit. When we get into production, we will be looking to hedge to protect our cash flow via a prudent hedging strategy once we get there later in the year. And then that will allow us over a longer time frame to get to a point where we can think about establishing a progressive dividend policy and looking at share buybacks as well once cash flow starts to come through over the next few years. And our strategy is very simple. Now that we've got the core of the development in place, let's deliver more growth through high return incremental opportunities that we can bring in, and that will give us more cash to look at distributions over time. Management are aligned. I've already mentioned that. We're all shareholders, and our compensation is aligned with shareholder returns. And also, obviously, Paul was asked the question in the last presentation. Yes, we are an attractive target. We focus on delivering the business. Obviously, we can understand why when once we're in production with compelling cash flows and we operate, we own our own infrastructure, why we might be an attractive proposition. And obviously, at the right price, one has to consider that. But the point is that we're fixed with low OPEX and low CO2 for barrel. So we're a high margin business with a low carbon footprint going forward. So very exciting year coming up as we get to cash flow. And I'll wrap up there, Sarah. Thank you.
And the smile on your face there where you said that, potential suitors possibly aren't too far away. That's my words, not yours. How lovely to hear the phrase indigenous gas, homegrown, home bottled for the local economy. You're a business with a low carbon footprint, free cash flow by the end of the year, a high quality team, but someone's missing. You are looking at the moment for a chief operating officer. So what kind of creature would this chief operating officer need to have?
Thanks for that question, Sarah. I mean, the first thing I should do, and I hope Mark may be on here, but I should acknowledge Mark Hughes's input to our organization and all that he's done the last 3 years for us. Mark decided to retire last November for health reasons, but he's helped us get to where we are, to have a credible, strong operating team in place, a very well-seasoned team ready to deliver our phase one development. So we have, because of the strength of the team that we've recruited over the last year or so, we have a great senior leadership team in place. So we're well positioned to keep the project moving along while we look for a new chief operating officer. Rupert Newell has kindly taken over as interim project director in the meantime, and is doing a great job really of keeping focus on the project, keeping things moving in a very positive direction. We're out there looking for someone who is obviously primarily with an engineering background, but also has a commercial head on them, because there are lots of commercial opportunities to be had here and to take advantage of as we move the company forward. So I think we're very comfortable on who it is we're looking for. We're running a process to make sure that we actually get the right successor to Mark in place. And I think we'll be able to announce that we've done that in the reasonably near future.
Okay, and maybe someone who's familiar with mergers and acquisitions, particularly if there are people circling IOG possibly, and also four key areas to growth. You've mentioned acquisitions that you're always looking around. In terms of potential acquisitions, is it a fertile ground in the southern North Sea?
I think I'd come back to the slide that I mentioned earlier. I think first place to go is what's in our portfolio already, because we know that we own it. We're working it up. We've spent a lot of money in the last year on reprocessing all of our 3D seismic across our entire portfolio, so we can have the best, most up-to-date technical view of it as is possible. So that's the place we go first. We look there, and that's what's going to be fed into phase two of our core project. Once we get phase one up and running, then we'll be focused very much on phase two. We've appointed a very capable and experienced pre-development asset manager to own and progress phase two, and Phil McIntyre. And Phil's looking very closely at what's already in the portfolio. We'll continue to look at what's available from licensing rounds, and we were successful in the 32nd round. That will also be added in as potentially part of growth of the rest of the portfolio. So we'll be doing that as well. And then, as I mentioned, around us, we have a constant review really of what's actually around us in terms of what might be stranded gas, what might have been left behind when parts of the infrastructure were shut down. So that's my third component. And then also we would look at acquisitions or of other entities potentially as well. So it's a mix really. It's a heady mix of several different types of potential add-ons to the portfolio, and we're looking at all of them. So that should give you a feel for the characteristics, the type of things that we'd like to bring in and grow. But we, the key thing for this year is to get to revenue later on in the year, and then free cash flow just afterwards. That we're really very focused on that at the moment, because that will allow us to really blossom in terms of what we can do as a company.
Blossom, as in spring. I suppose it's all down to affordability as well in terms of potential acquisitions. Now, a question from your predecessor, he asks, can IOG get to first gas without another equity fundraise?
That's from Mark, I guess. Evening, Mark. Thank you very much. Based on our current outlook, we don't have any plans to raise further equity in 2021. We have the carry. We have the bond funds that we can utilize on alongside the carry to get us the first gas. We can never absolutely make cast iron guarantees, but our outlook doesn't envisage us needing to raise further equity in 2021. We've still got some way to go to get phase one done, but that's how we see it today. We still believe that we're on track to get first gas in Q3 this year and be cash flow positive by the end of the year. And that's especially going to be the case if gas prices remain at the encouraging level that we're seeing at the moment.
So we've spent a lot of time talking about phase one, but Jaco Flumer asks, timing and scope for phase two, please.
So, hello, Jaco. Good evening. Good to hear from you as well. Jaco is a great supporter of ours, and it's good to know he's on. Earlier on, phase two is in hand. We've appointed a dedicated manager, Phil McIntyre, to deliver phase two. Currently, where we are is we're reevaluating all of our portfolio, and we're having taken advantage of a very competitive market last year to reprocess our 3D seismic across the portfolio and get a great update in our subsurface imaging. So we're working hard on that. And then we're looking really to be at a point where we can consider what it is that we're going to take final investment decisions on later in the year. So we expect over the coming months to have quite a lot to say about what we're going to be doing on phase two and indeed other incremental assets beyond phase two as well. So we do see incremental opportunities around the portfolio. We have incremental opportunities within the portfolio. So I think we're well placed, but it's over the course really of this year that we'll begin to start to really focus on what's going to be sanctioned for phase two.
We've got a very elegant question from Rebecca, who says, elegant partnership with Cal Energy, a robust position in what is a mature basin. Mm-hmm. She says, can you comment on the balance or the appetite for organic versus inorganic investment, which sounds like the makings of a real thought leadership piece there. So I've put that comment up so you can read it.
Right. Organic as opposed to inorganic investment in IOG specifically.
I'm assuming so. Rebecca's questions are quite thought-provoking, so you can answer it whichever way you like.
Okay, so I think where we see ourselves currently, Rebecca, is obviously we are an AIM-listed company wanting to deliver returns for shareholders, and the way we see to get to that is by being a material gas producer in the gas basin where we know what we're doing. We're currently looking at the first step in that. The first step in that is to get ourselves to the point later on in the year where we can stand on our own two feet because cash is coming into the business. Then that opens up all kinds of opportunities for us looking outward because we'll be able to, we really will be in control of our own destiny. Whereas at the moment, obviously, we're managing as best we can our way through the development using our carry and using our bond raise to get the development done and get us to cash. I think once we get to cash, then we'll have much wider horizons that we can look at in terms of investment. What we want to be at the moment, though, is a compelling proposition for shareholders who want to get a return. I think that's what we're really about at the moment.
Okay, so we've spoken about the free cash flow by the end of the year. Christopher Calvert takes this further. He says, What is the projected free cash flow in 2022 when gas is online?
So I don't think we've actually released that to the market. That we so I have to be careful what I say here in terms of actually quantifying that. So I'm not going to quantify that because we haven't let the market know where we are with that. But what we can say is that there will be material free cash flow thrown off from our production stream by the time we get to year end.
Okay, I'll wrap up a few of the other questions that have appeared, which is all about, I suppose, communications. Are you going to engage more with investors and with analysts? So I'm guessing that the underlying theme is that perhaps you've been a bit quiet in the past.
Yeah, I'm often surprised by this, particularly recently, I think. I mean, obviously, we're doing this evening and we've done one or two other events with you guys, but we have been putting out really very regular corporate updates. I think we did one in mid-November. We've just done one this week. So we put out fairly detailed corporate updates. There is a very detailed investor presentation on our website, which I would recommend everyone to go and have a look at. It's a more expansive document than the one I've just presented from here this evening. I interviewed by Malcolm Graham Wood just back in the back end of early December, late November, early December last year. So I think over the year, our head of IR, James Chance, has done a really great job of improving our outward communications. It can always be better, obviously, but I think we have put in place a structure really where we do regularly talk to the analysts. We regularly talk to our bondholders as investors as well, and we are putting out very regular corporate updates for investors to look at, both via the website and through RNS.
And I listened to Malky's interview that's related to IOG, and he said, strong partner in Cal Energy, returning significant cash flow to shareholders, owns all its own infrastructure and onshore facilities, having made real progress in 2020 in difficult conditions. We expect complete fabrication of the phase one platforms this quarter and start development drilling by early Q2. So there you go. You've got an ambassador in Malky who isn't the big softy that we think he is. He can be quite ferocious. But with that, time is up. And thank you very, very, very much indeed, Andrew. Don't be a stranger. Proactive investor events are very well in attended, as you know. And thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Sarah, and thanks to everyone for listening to me and for the last half hour of your time. Much appreciated. Thank you.